In this drawing, we're going to find out what happens to that three-layer germ disk. So I actually want to start by looking at the last picture we drew at the end of the last drawing. Let's take a look at this and remind ourselves what happened here. We saw the three layers forming. Remember, we had two and then there was three. And we saw also, this picture turns out to be fairly important for the next drawing. Remember, we saw this little area here develop called the amniotic cavity. And then there's a little area here developing called the yolk sac. So what we're going to draw first is this disc, but tipped up. You see here, we're seeing it at about this angle. We're seeing a little of the top, and then we're seeing the side. First, we're going to tip it up and see what it looks like straight down like that. So let's start right here in this space where it says top view of three-layer disc. And we're going to draw a little oval. I'll let you see the bottom down there, so you can put it right in about here. We want to draw. Now, they always draw it as kind of an oval, not a perfect circle. In our drawings, it kind of looked like it was a perfect circle, but they always draw it as slightly oval. So I'm just going to imitate what I've seen on websites, and we will make ours slightly oval. So that's the top view. So next we want to make a line right here. Now about halfway up or so. Put a little dot, and sometimes they draw like a little curved line. Sometimes it goes all the way around and makes a circle, but other times you'll see a little curved line. And occasionally they'll have a dot up here too. But this is the most important, this line and this little thing. And this is called the primitive streak. Now, primitive just means first. Prime means first. So this just means the very first thing that's going to appear. It's a perfectly flat, smooth disk, and then this little streak appears on it. And this little thing here they call the primitive pit. And this they call the primitive node. Node just means a central area. And this little thing here, I'm not going to bother labeling the right name. Basically, this is going to be the future mouth area. And a lot of drawings don't even have that dot, but if you see the dot there, that's what that is. It's a little area that's going to eventually develop into our mouth and throat area. So that's how the human body starts out. A little streak, a node, a dot on top of a three-layer disc. We are going to take a cross section. You can kind of make a dashed line kind of across the middle right about here. Right, and then if you want to make an arrow or something, our cross section. So remember I said we're going to take a look at straight down, and then we're going to tip this on its side, and we're going to see primarily this end. We'll put a little bit of a curve back here to remind us what we're looking at. But we're primarily interested in the cross section. So I'm going to zoom in a little bit more here. And we are going to make this into three layers. And then let's just add a little bit of a curve back here. Like that. Okay, so we have a cake that's sliced in half, a three-layer cake. And we're looking at the back half of the cake. And let's put, like you can see in our cross-section over here, we're going to see just a little bit of this streak here, okay. So we're kind of looking right across that primitive streak, what's underneath that primitive streak. And we can label these layers. They're the same. Ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. And you know what colors they would be. We already did that. The endoderm is always yellow. Always, always, always. Every drawing I've ever seen, the endoderm is yellow. It's really nice that they've really standardized that, because then embryology is confusing enough without having to keep track of colors. It's nice they really are consistent. No matter what publisher is drawing it, no matter what lecturer is drawing, they always use these colors. Mesoderm is always red. Now keep your colors kind of light because I want to draw on top of it. And then the ectoderm is, the ectoderm is blue. So this would be part of the ectoderm too, right? The top would be blue. Since we're looking at the top of our top layer. And you'll remember that as early as this drawing here, actually. The notochord, we have a little dot. We said the notochord starts, and here it is again, and here it wasn't here. Now the notochord is going to become very important right now. I'll put it in right there. Okay, so it would be running like this, like my pencil. We're just seeing the end of it. It would be a cord going long ways. So we're just seeing a cut. The notochord, which we should label actually, is the area that it's like the foreman on the building crew. It's the manager that tells everybody else what to do. This area will secrete chemicals that will go and affect all the other cells. Now, how do these cells know that they're in charge? I don't think anybody really knows exactly why these start to express DNA that makes them into the boss. You know, why doesn't a cell over here decide that, hey, I think I'd like to be in charge? But right here, they know, the cells know where they are in this layer. They know they're in the center. And they start expressing a protein. So let's make some dots. These little protein chemicals. These are going to be our little... Now, of course, that would be very out of scale. We wouldn't actually see these tiny proteins, even at this scale. But it starts secreting a protein that will affect these cells. Because remember, these layers are made up of cells, right? Hundreds or thousands of cells at this point. So the concentration is going to be less out here, and very great in here. The concentration of this chemical is very important. The dose you get determines how it's going to affect you. Okay, so this protein is called SHH, and this stands for, and I'm not kidding here, it actually does stand for sonic hedgehog protein. So it's SHH, the hedgehog. Now, if you aren't familiar with Sonic the Hedgehog, I will show you a picture of him. Let's back out a little bit. There's Sonic the Hedgehog. And yes, the protein really is named after him. Now, why in the world would you name a protein after a hedgehog cartoon character? Well, the scientists that discovered this protein, they were studying what's going on here, and they isolated this protein. They gave a huge dose of it to a little fruit fly larva. Okay, so they said, we really want to see what this thing does, so we're going to just feed this larva an immense amount, and then it'll be obvious what this thing does. You know, if it comes out with 8 heads, we'll know that this protein has something to do with heads. So this is the way the fruit fly turned out. And apparently what the SHH protein had done was make it grow all these appendages. Now, the fruit fly isn't supposed to be hairy like that, but it made it grow all these extra hairs, and it reminded them of a hedgehog. And at that particular time, Sonic the Hedgehog was a very popular character, and so it was kind of obvious to name it after Sonic. So for once, scientists kind of had a sense of humor. I like that. Now, I want to take a little pause here for some notochord trivia. If you've done any classification of animals, you know that there's a big divide between animals with bones and invertebrates. And we would assume that it goes something like this. There's a big giant phylum for animals with bones, and there's a hot giant category for no bones. And simple as that, right? Either have bones or you don't. But actually, it's a little more complicated than that. You have a phylum called Chordata, and then you have all your other, you have invertebrates, you have different worms, and they each have their own phylum. You have echinoderms, that's starfish, and you have all these groups over here. But over here you have something called chordata, and that means not that you have bones, but it means that you have a notochord. You either have one as an adult or you had one as a baby. Now, humans don't keep their notochords. We develop real spinal columns, bones and nerves and muscle. But some animals keep their notochord and never develop a spinal cord. So this is a great piece of trivia to know. You can really stump people if you know this, that there are some animals that are chordates. So chordata does not mean it has bones, okay? This phylum gets then divided up, okay, into, then you have the vertebrates that have bones. And we're familiar with the fish, you know, the reptiles, etc., under there. But there's other chordates that keep their notochords and don't develop bones. And there's things called tunicates and salps, and there's the famous one, the amphioxus. And these are mostly ocean creatures that have a notochord or had a notochord at some point in their embryology. These are tunicates. So they're in the same phylum, the chordata phylum, with humans. Is that odd? They look like little sponges or something, but there's these little tubes, and the water flows in and out. They're filter feeders, and they sometimes are called sea squirts because they can push the water in and squirt it out. And so these guys had a notochord, or maybe they still have a notochord, and so they're chordata. Isn't that odd? Okay, even odder, this thing called a salp. It's clear. I mean, I wouldn't even know what that was if I pulled that up on my fishing hook. And even stranger, the salps can get together and form these long colonies. And these things might be 100 feet long, you know, 30, 40, 50 meters long, hugely long lines of these little salp individuals all hooked together to make like a mega animal. Each one of these is a zooid, and they live in a colony, and they function as one animal. Here's another classic example of a boneless chordate. This is the amphioxus, also known as the lancelet, and it is this kind of eyeless, mouthless, gillless, we can't even call it a fish. I don't know what it is. It's an amphioxus. And it's got, this is kind of the head region and the tail region. And you can see in this cutaway diagram, this blue thing running along like that is the notochord, not to be confused with the nerve cord. So if you see a cutaway of a similar organism that might look similar on the outside, some kind of eel or fish or something, you're not going to see a notochord labeled, only in the amphioxus. And here's another classic example you'll see listed quite often of a boneless chordate. And this is the lamprey. And if you look at the end of the face like this, if you could look straight in at the end of the head, this is what you would see right there. Kind of nasty, like a sucker with little teeth on the inside. Yeah, wouldn't want to get bit by that. I think they go and kind of attach themselves to larger animals and take a chunk out of them. So here's the cutaway again, and you'll see a notochord listed. And another organism that maybe looks very similar, you know, some kind of an eel or something, if you saw a similar diagram, you would not see a notochord. So that's a great piece of trivia that you can pull on somebody if you know that chordata doesn't mean vertebrate. It doesn't mean you have bones. It means you had a notochord. And after you have a notochord, you can be a vertebrate or you can be one of these weird sea creatures. So let's find out what the notochord is going to do to that primitive streak. So the notochord's job is to secrete SHH, sonic hedgehog protein, and that will direct the other cells in their development. There's other kinds of hedgehogs too. There's desert hedgehog protein and there's Indian hedgehog protein, and those are actually named after real hedgehogs. Sonic is the cartoon one. So, all right, so we're going to start out with a line, but we're going to erase in here. This is why we draw in pencil. We're going to make a little spot in here. We're going to put a little wiggle up and down. So we want to make like a little C-shaped thing. Let's see, going up. How do we do this? Like up and down and up and down like that. Two little waves. That. And then I'm going to make this ectoderm kind of thinner. We're going to be a little pressed for space down there, so make the ectoderm thin. So the ectoderm gets these little bumps in the top, wherever the primitive streak was. If we draw our little back curve, we can put sort of a shadow right here. It'll help us see that it's actually a groove that we formed. And it's called the neural groove. Neural, as in neurons in neurology. The neural groove. Okay, does that kind of look like it's a kind of a dent going back in space like that? Kind of like a... Okay. And then we're going to keep track of the cells that are right here. They're going to actually turn out to be important. There's not really a circle here, okay, but this section right here, in fact, let's make it a different color. Let's use like a green or something. to keep track of this instead of blue. These are ectoderm cells, but I want us to be able to see where these particular cells go. So this will be blue. The green is kind of blue with a tweak. So this can be blue. Just make it nice and light. Don't cover over your neural groove shading there. And there's a name for these. They're called the neural crest cells. So if this is a wave, then this would be like the crest of the wave, right? This would be the trough of the wave, they call it. And these would be the crests of the wave. So these are called neural crest cells. Neural crest cells. So let's put the endoderm down here. We won't label them ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. You'll just know because of the color. If we make it yellow, you know that's endoderm. And then we'll have our notochord right here. And make all our little sonic hedgehog proteins going out. So we don't need to keep our notochord because it has a temporary job. Right, this is a structure that's very needed in embryology, but we don't need a notochord to tell our cells what to do later on in life. So then this is going to disappear eventually. Okay, so that's still our notochord, just like we've labeled it over here. If you want to label it again, you can. But it's the same as here, notochord, SSH proteins, and it's red. Mesoderm. Make sure you don't obscure those little dots. Go real easy over it. Okay. Now we're going to see what happens to the neural groove. Come down here. And the groove is going to turn into a tube. So we want to make sort of like our where our wave was, but it's going to go not so high, and you want to come almost to the center. Leave a little space. We're not going to close it yet. Go like that, and then like that. You see, those were the crest areas, and in fact, we can make those green because that's exactly what it is. The crests kind of come in like that. You can see how they're going to form a tube. So in our back view here, it'll look like something like that. Okay, where it's gonna fold back together. Actually, you don't even really have to color this top. If you just did the layers, it would be fine. And we're going to try to wedge in here. We got our notochord, and then our endoderm is going to be kind of low in that picture. That's okay. Now, this is actually very important. This stage is called neurulation, the formation of the neural tube. Special word for that. We have blastulation and gastrulation and neurulation. Oh, there it is. Okay. But more important than memorizing the vocabulary is actually understanding what's going on. So if you forget the words blastulation and gastrulation or ulation, it's not a huge deal. Unless you're going into embryology, and then you really do have to remember them. Okay, let's make our little... The most important thing is to understand what's going on. We've got this little notochord area, and it's giving instructions to all the other cells. And it's telling these cells to do this and to fold and become like a tube. Okay, so in this picture, we just have that crusty wave thing rolling together. Now in this step, we see the tube completely formed. So, you know, you can also come up a little bit. You want plenty of room for this one. You can even bring your top line up a little bit. Make sure it's plenty high here, because we're going to have the ectoderm flat again. This piece heals over, that groove disappears, and that tube, it joins together and then sinks down like this. So we have a tube, and then remember those neural crest cells that were riding there? Well, they kind of split off and go like this. And then we have the notochord still sitting there. And we still have the endoderm on the bottom. So I'm going to make this blue, because remember it used to be ectoderm. Remember we said that the ectoderm was going to turn into the epidermis and the brain and all the nerves. That was one of the things it was going to turn into, is the nervous system. And there you go, it's starting to form what's going to be the spinal cord. Now let's just keep these green for a minute. They're actually usually shown as blue in most drawings, as they are from the ectoderm. But just to make sure that we know that's where they came from, they were riding on that crest of the wave. And when they came down, the wave crests kind of got separated out to here and here. So let's make our curve along the back. And now this is no longer called the neural groove. It's an actual little tube. So it's called the neural tube. Neural tube. And I'm not going to have to draw anything in here, so I can word slop over. That's fine. And you can read down here, neural tube will become brain and spinal cord. And the neural crests will be peripheral nervous system and more. So again, we have neural crest cells, just like in our other drawing. So all we did in this drawing was roll that groove into a tube. Alrighty, we need to make some red mesoderm. Pretty soon we're going to see something happening in all this mesoderm, because it's not just sitting here. Things are happening already. We're just breaking it down step by step. As I've said before, this is way, way simplified. Embryology is so complex. We're trying to break it down and make the steps very simple for you. So really, you're going to see some action happening here already, but we're going to wait and do it in this next drawing. Okay, ready for what happens to the mesoderm right here. And we really need to have enough space. You might want to raise these just a tad. So we're going to have the ectoderm there. We're going to have a little endoderm down here. See, I can go ahead and make a curve along the back. And we're still going to have the neural tube right here. We're still going to have the notochord. We're still going to have these neural crest cells. Although now they break off. There's actually like a clump of them. They kind of get clumpy around there eventually. And then one of the things that's happening in the mesoderm, so right here, you have two tubes forming. And these are the heart tubes. So one of the first things that starts to develop is the heart. Way before there's even any liver or kidneys or anything, the heart is one of the first things that starts to develop. And it starts out as two tubes. Here's a helpful little diagram I found on Wikipedia about heart formation. Here's the heart tubes. And of course, we're looking at the little ends of the tubes in our drawing. But here you can see them lengthwise. And then they move together and kind of fuse together in the middle. And then the tubes stay there, but this middle part starts to really change and grow, kind of twist around and morph and turn into ventricles and atria, and the tubes really stay down here. I don't know why they removed them, but you still have tubes coming out the bottom of your heart. And somewhere around in here is when the cells of the heart start beating together. They all start to beat. Even before it's completely formed, the cells will start to contract together in rhythm. So what else is going on here in the mesoderm? We're just going to represent it by little lines. Now there are no lines, of course. We're just way oversimplifying. But there are certain areas that begin to develop. Here, let's split this into three. Two, three, like that. And on the other side. And then this area out here, very importantly, is going to split in half. So we can color it in. I think I'm going to make these a little bit darker because we're going to have this red coming in here. Make it light. And each of these areas will concentrate on becoming something different. So we have here close called the paraxial, and they have names for each of these sections. I won't bother you with the names. But there are names for each one of them. But the names make sense. Lateral on the sides and paraxial is on the side of the axis, the center. So the names do make sense. So the DNA expressed in these cells suddenly is going to open up instructions on how to make things like internal organs and muscles and bone. And the ones on the side here are going to make use of other sections of the DNA to get information on how to be other things. And the notochord keeps churning away at that sonic hedgehog. We won't put all the little dots in now. but you know that's what the notochord is doing. Okay, blue. I'm just going to make these blue now. These are because they're going to be part of the nervous system. And then the heart tubes. I don't know, maybe we can. I'm just going to leave them. I'm not going to color them in because that'll be too confusing. Now, these little things here. Actually, I'm going to put my blue in first. Let me say something more about those little neural crest cells. In the next picture, we're going to see them again, and we're going to see some other changes happening in, right in here. Like I said, we've broken this down step by step. You would see, actually, some changes going on right in here. There would be kind of a couple of lumps forming right below here, which we'll see in the next picture. But these little tiny dots are going to become the nerves that are going out from the spinal cord. So if I show you real quickly here, I'm going to show it again in a minute, show a picture of the spine. You see that in the center, there's a big hole down here. This is where the main spinal cord, the nerve, would run down through here. See my pencil through there? Peeking through? Okay, that's where the spinal cord would run. But out here, these holes coming out here would be nerves. Coming out the hole, there'd be nerves that would be running out to different parts of the body. And so the nerves that are coming out of here, these are where they came from, right here. So it's not like the spinal cord started growing nerves out and they went out and out and out. No, the nerves that are outside started outside and then they just made connections like this. So our note here says mesoderm begins to differentiate and heart tubes appear. That's the most important thing that happens in this step, is those heart tubes appearing. Before we start labeling and coloring this next picture, I want to go back again and take a look at the last picture that we saw where the three-layer disc was attached to the amnion and the yolk sac. And that would be this one right here. Remember, we had this amniotic cavity forming here and the yolk sac and the three layers, and we've already seen what happens to the three layers. And then we tipped it like that. And that's a little more like what we've been seeing with the notochord there. And we took this cross section and we've been looking at it. But in the past few pictures, we haven't seen this or this. So we're going to go back to putting those in the picture. So here's our amniotic cavity and there's the yolk sac. And we can go ahead and label those. Yolk sac. And let's just label this outer membrane as the amnion. Now remember, this whole thing is still inside the chorion, as in this picture, right? It's still inside this outer ring. We don't have that drawn here, but you have to imagine we have this chorion, and then we'd have a little connecting stalk connecting it. Now we're going to discuss each of these areas and we'll label them. But for the labeling, I'm going to suggest exactly where to put the words because I've kind of figured out how to get all the words in. Otherwise, you're going to run out of space perhaps. So that's why I've left this picture showing a little bit here, because we're going to put some words right here and then we can double up and we can make an arrow pointing this way and this way and just write the word once and put an arrow on either side. I think that'll work out well. But let's start with just a few labels here, and then we'll write a bunch of words down here. And then we'll kind of save the coloring for last. Let's label a few structures that we already know. You're going to recognize the neural tube and the notochord and the neural crest cells and the heart tubes. So let's label right here, point to the neural crest cells. In fact, I'm going to maybe wait and label the neural tube on the other one. Let's label neural crest cells, and let's make a note that they will become, you got to write small here too, just don't write too large, will become peripheral, peri, P-E-R-I, P-H-E-R-A-L, peripheral means kind of on the outside, peripheral nerves, and then I'm just going to put and more. Some of these guys are going to decide to become connective tissue, the bones of the inner ear, and very oddly, some of them are going to decide not to be nervous tissue at all, and they're going to go become melanocytes, the little pigment cells in your skin. So those are kind of some of the lesser known things that the neural crest cells develop into. But if you just remember that these become the nerves outside the spine, then that's great. That's the most important thing. And as I showed you on the spine, there's these holes. This is where the cord goes through down the middle here, and then there's these areas, these holes where the nerves come out and they run out and go to other places, and there's little clumps of nerves called a ganglion that sit out here, and those come from the neural crest cells. So remember, it's not as if the spinal cord grows nerves out. The nerves grow out here and then they just connect. Let's go ahead and write a note about the underside here of the endoderm. Remember, this will be the yellow endoderm running along here. Endoderm. And it becomes inside of gut tube. And we'll see the gut tube in the next picture. And then the bottom here, this part of yolk sac will make blood cells and blood vessels. Oddly enough, we're going to see some little things develop down here that are going to turn into complete sections of little blood vessels. This will go on at another place in the embryo too, but it does happen here. Because I'm sure you're wondering, yolk sac, we don't need yolk. What in the world goes on in the yolk sac? And it's all about blood production and blood vessel production. It doesn't have anything to do with the yellow yolk that you eat in chicken eggs. And I guess we could go ahead and just color this yellow. I think we're done with this endoderm part in this drawing. This is the last time you'll see it looking so simple. It's going to be more complex from here out. And let's go ahead and color the top part blue. I think we're done labeling this amnion. And this is our ectoderm. Actually, you know what? I think we need to wait. We're going to put some arrows coming in over here. Let's wait and not color the right side. And wait till I put my arrows in, and then we can kind of color in and around it. But just having this much color helps you orient yourself to our three layers. Now let's focus on these things and these little bumps. Remember in this drawing, we saw how the mesoderm started to split up and each part is going to do something different. Well, now we see that this first part has gotten much larger and divided into several sections within itself, And these little lines here indicate that this is like a little ball, sort of. And then there's a one behind that, and one behind that, and one behind that, one behind that. And let me show you a picture of a real embryo where you can see these little things. They're called somites. There's a nice Gray's Anatomy picture. If you were to look at the embryo from the top at this stage, or approximately this stage, you're going to see somites. And there will be a total of 43 pairs eventually. This is the yolk sac peeking out underneath, and they have this labeled where they've removed the amnion. So it's like you're looking at it like this. Okay, and the amniotic sac would go around like this. And this is that yellow thing going underneath. So they've trimmed away the blue sac on top to let you look straight down here like that. Now this looks pretty goofy. You don't really see that in our drawing. We're going to make a little bump here to indicate this, and we'll make it a little wavy back here, but this really looks goofy. This is going to be the brain eventually, the head and brain area. So you can probably guess that the somites are going to turn into the vertebrae in your back, but not just that. Somites are a little more complicated than that. The somites are not only going to turn into the bones of your vertebrae, but they're also going to turn into the muscle and the skin that surrounds them. So basically your entire back is going to come from here. When you think about it, muscle can be segmented. We know that the vertebrae are segmented, that's obvious. But muscles kind of come in little segments also, and this is most easily seen in your abdomen. If you are real skinny and you can see your muscles in your abdomen, you can see that those, sometimes people call it a six-pack, you can see those sections of muscle. So muscles also come in sections. So each one of these is going to make muscle and bone and the covering skin as well. So let's label these with their names, somite. And my advice is to make the arrow going here. Let's write the word somites right about here. That. And then keep the arrow kind of high. We'll point to this one. And we'll also point to these. Okay, so that's pointing to this thing and all those little bumps. And the three regions of the somite area, they have fancy names, but all you need to know is that this one, let's see, let's point to the top one. Actually, let's point to this top layer of blue, the ectoderm. Point to the ectoderm and let's write epidermis. Because then this next layer, that first top layer of the somite, is going to turn into dermis. And that's the underlayer of the skin. The epi is the outer part of the skin, that's what you see. And the dermis is that deep layer of skin. Then the middle part here is going to turn into muscle. And the inner one is going to turn into bone. So they have fancy names, myoderm, scleroderm. They just use the Greek and Latin words for muscle and bone to give these special names. But all you need to know is that's the skin, muscle, and bone. And when you think about it, if you cut into yourself, you get the epidermis, then you go through the dermis, then you go through muscle, and then you hit bone. Right, that's the order in which things come if you would kind of slice into yourself. So this is why they're in that order. It started very early on right here, the ordering of bone being on the inside and then muscle and then skin. Now the somites are going to have to move and change shape a lot because here sits the neural tube, which is going to be the spinal cord, the very soft nervous tissue in the center. So don't get the spinal cord and the spinal column mixed up. The bones, this is the spinal column, but the cord is what my pencil is representing. The cord is the soft nervous tissue on the inside. That's the cord. And the bones are the column. So these are going to form the bone, the muscle, and the skin around that soft cord. So they're going to have to really move and shift, and this thing is going to be forming the skin, the outer layer. It's going to have to run along and go underneath all this ectoderm eventually. And then the bone is going to have to form not only the vertebrae, but also the rib cage is going to come from this area. So this area is going to basically develop your entire torso, all the bones and muscles in the main part of your body. This next area right here, point to it, just going to develop into what is called the urogenital system. Of course, uro refers to urine. That's your kidneys, your bladder, everything that is involved in urine production. And genital means reproductive. So in the males, this would be your testes, and in the female would be the ovaries and the uterus. So you know that they're very close. In fact, in males, they actually share parts. The urinary system and the reproductive systems use some of the same tubes. So they are very interconnected. They came from the same area of the mesoderm. So let's just put a note here. We mean kidneys, bladder, and I'm just going to put repro for reproductive, either male or female. Now, what about this last area? This is called the lateral mesoderm because it's out on the sides, and it's split. It wasn't split in the last picture. We saw a line, but now it's actually split, and it's going to become very different things. So we're going to write a word, some words here and here, and kind of point up to them. This side is going to become sacs around organs, plus eventually, this is kind of strange, plus eventually arms and legs. The appendages are going to kind of grow out of this area. So this is really going to grow and extend and change a lot. And this is also going to become sacs around organs. And these would be the inner ones. And now I'm going to show some pictures to explain this. So don't panic if you don't understand this. I'm going to show you what I mean. All your organs are sort of inside of bags. Of course, not plastic bags. They're bags made of connective tissue, those kind of thin membranes. If you've ever chopped up a chicken, a raw chicken, to cook it, and you've looked at the inside of the chicken or even around the muscles of the chicken, you'll notice that the muscles are inside these thin kind of membranous bags. Well, we have these membranes inside of us as well. And let's look at this picture where we see a cross-section of your abdomen. And this is oversimplified. I think it really shows it fairly well. There is an outer bag, trace around here, all the way around. The fancy name for it is peritoneum, like this. It's going all the way around, but it doesn't include, this is female, the uterus goes around there, and includes all your organs. We kind of have this outer layer. And then inside, each organ is in a bag. So see this layer, there's a bag, it's there, I think that's supposed to be the liver. This is in a bag, intestines are all in a bag. So your organs are like double bagged. They each have their own bag, and then those bags are within bags. So there's a lot of membranes inside. And even between the intestines, this inner bag grows extra membranes. I don't think this is human, actually. I think maybe this is like sheep or something. So here's the intestines, and they've kind of pulled the intestines apart. Like, you might imagine the intestines as kind of just being a bunch of spaghetti sitting inside of you, but that's not right. All of the pieces of intestine are connected together with this membrane. So when you first open up a body, you wouldn't see this exactly, but if you pull the intestines apart, you're going to see this thin membrane. And this is the surface along which blood vessels can run. And though you can't see them, there will be nerves running through here. So you think this all has to have a blood supply. It's very, very important for the intestines to have a blood supply, because it's digesting food and all the nutrients have to go into your blood. And another important membrane to know about is around the heart, the pericardium. So it's like your heart is in a bag, except it's not really like in a bag like you would imagine opening up a plastic bag. Zoom out a little bit here. Opening up a plastic bag, and I can put the heart in it like that. That's not the way it is. It's more like this. There's a double layer there, okay, and the heart gets wrapped in the bag like this. That's more correct. So therefore, I could put water into the bag. See, if I open this up right here, what happened if I put water into the bag? Would the heart get wet? No, because it would be all in between here, right? The fluid would be all inside the bag and yet around the heart. And the lungs also have this set up. So that's how you can get fluid around your heart or fluid around your lungs and not actually have it in your organs. It's these bags that fill up. So if you hear somebody saying they have water on their lungs, they probably mean that this bag is retaining too much water. There is supposed to be a little bit in there because it's supposed to be slippery. That's part of the design. Things can move around and slip, and they're all lubricated. They're held in place, and yet they have lubrication and slippiness for movement. Just the right amount of movement and just the right amount of firmness. But if you get too much fluid inside the bag, then what is going to be kind of like squeezing, putting pressure on the heart or on the lungs, and that'll make it difficult for your heart to beat, or it'll make it difficult to breathe if you have too much fluid inside this bag. So let's add just a little bit of color here, and then we're going to talk more about those membranes in just a second. We're going to see how they surround the organs. Let's just finish this up. Now that we have all those arrows in, you can kind of see where not to color. Remember, don't cover up words and arrows. When in doubt, keep it light and don't color. It would be fine even if you didn't color this in. Just if you do, keep it really super light. Okay, now for a big change. The embryo is starting to curl a little bit, but now it's really going to curl. It's called embryonic folding. So we'll let's go over to this picture, and we're going to use some of these words to label this one over here. And first I want to go back to showing you this. Remember, I think I had this in the last drawing where I showed you how the embryo folds. And we're going to put the amniotic cavity on there. So now we have blue ectoderm and the red mesoderm and the kind of yellowish endoderm, just like in this picture right here, right? And there's the amnion over the top. So now what's happening between this picture and this picture? So this whole thing is folding, curling around like this. And you'll see the yellow layer there, the endoderm, becomes the gut tube. And it's surrounded by the mesoderm and it's got the ectoderm around that. So that's how your skin gets on the outside. And then you've got muscle and bone, and then your digestive tract is on the very inside. So let's see our illustration of it here. Let's go ahead and color this outside blue. The colors are really going to help you keep things straight here. This gets kind of confusing. Probably not even sure what we're looking at. So let's go ahead and make this outer amnion. And then this inner layer, so what we just colored is this top part. So as it bends, this point here comes way down. This point here would be right here. So this would also be blue. This is the ectoderm. And fairly soon we're going to stop calling it the ectoderm. It's just going to be the epidermis. Okay, so do you see how that changed from this shape to this shape, really looking like a C now instead of just like a banana. And we still have the neural tube. I didn't draw neural crest cells. If you want to put some dots in there, you can add a few. And we still have the notochord. So if you want to label that, you don't have to, but if you want to, we have neural tube, notochord. And then next, let's tackle this yellow part. Let's save the mesoderm to the last, like we did before. And it actually doesn't just squeeze into a tube. When I did my little felt pieces there, I just kind of rolled them like this. But actually, this thing folds in, like, kind of into like an eight. It's kind of hard to do, which is why I didn't do it. It kind of folds into something like that. So let's label this gut tube. And this is still called the yolk sac down here. This is going to get smaller and smaller and kind of disappear, just go in and shrink and disappear. It's going to stop being very important. So it's going to, this will get larger and this will get smaller until it's gone. Okay, I think that's all we need to say about that, except for these little dots down here. Make them red. And label them as blood islands. That sounds like not a good place to vacation. Can you imagine if there was something called the blood islands? Okay. And there's a note about them down here. Blood islands appear in the yolk sac and will become complete little sections of vessel with red blood cells already inside. And I found a very old-fashioned picture. Hopefully I can zoom in close enough. There, I think you'll be able to see. So here we have in the yolk sac, this is the way they've drawn these little blood islands here, 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 here. And then also they appear in other places. They're appearing in the this connecting stalk and outside here also. So we're going to zoom in on one of these little blood islands, and let's say it looks like this, a clump of cells. All right, it starts out with a clump of cells that know that they would like to be something related to blood. And then what happens next is the cells in the middle here, these cells, they're doing mitosis, so there's more of them over here, but these cells decide that they're on the inside. They know they're on the inside, so they become blood cells. They actually become little red blood cells that can float around. And the cells on the outside here, they know they're on the outside, and so they start to form a ring here, see? And they will become the walls of the little blood vessels. And the ones on the very, very outside know that they have to become some little bit of muscle and connective tissue that are surrounding the vessels. So from a group of undifferentiated cells, we get a little piece of vessel that already has blood running through it. So you might wonder, well, how does the blood get into your vessels? Did all your blood vessels grow and then you started producing blood, and then one day it's like turning on a nozzle on a hose, and then the blood just gushed into the veins and filled everything? No, it actually started out as little sections of vessels. So this might be, you know, a little section like this, right? And it's got cells in it and everything. And there's a whole bunch of these floating around. And then they just had to kind of connect up together. This one would grow, and this one would be growing, and they'd find each other, and they'd find another one. And eventually they'd form a little network. So the yolk sac is going to end up looking like this. It's going to be a network of blood vessels. So this is the embryo here. This is the amnion. This is the embryo. And there's going to be some blood vessels forming in here too. And they're going to eventually connect up with all these in the yolk sac. And then they're going to run out here because they've got to get to the placenta to be in contact with his mother's blood. So the blood is going to get kind of circulation like this. But eventually, like I said, these will kind of disappear, and the network, it'll spread into here, and these will just kind of become your capillaries in your body. So now for the mesoderm. We see the somites are represented by these things right here. Now, in this picture, the somites were actually more complicated. We had these three areas. This picture, we're just going to make them like that, right? This was our kind of our zoomed-in version of it, and this is our at-a-distance version. So let's use this word somite and go over and point to it like that. And these are the little heart tubes down here, and I don't have them labeled over here, so you'll have to kind of sneak a line in like that. Heart tubes. And remember how we said this area next to it was going to start becoming the urogenital system? Well, let's put in little spots that are becoming kidneys. Let's label these future kidneys. And then we can kind of make this generally red here. And there would be other things going on in these other areas. Remember, this is horrendously simplified. Really, really simplified. A little more complicated than this, but. This makes it much easier to get the general impression. Okay, so let's bring these layers down and see where they came from. These are the two branches that we're splitting off over here. And hopefully this will make sense now, these sacs. So urogenital, we already have kidneys labeled over there. So we're going to use this word, sacs around organs. So this one here would be the outer one, right? If this curved down, and this curve down, that would be these two right here. So this needs to point to there, like that, or to here, like this. You could do either one or both, doesn't matter. So that's the outer one, and then this one, the inner one, and maybe I'm not gonna, it might be, it's gonna get all messed up with that arrow. I think I'll just let it point to that one. Alright, so those are the sacs around the organ, the inner sacs. So there's where your double layer of bag is. So there's where the opening would be, sort of. This would be the top of the bag where you could put your hand in for your little object. Right, so this is the bag. So the gut tube is kind of in this double layer of bag. And there's the inner layer and the outer layer. So this is where the fluid would be. Now in our bag, there's not a lot of space between these two layers. And in the body, there's not a whole lot of space. You don't have this much empty space. The embryo starts out with a lot of empty space here. And then this just shrinks and shrinks until these get really close. But right now, there's a big cavity there. And it has a special name, but I won't bother you with it. Important thing to know is that these connective tissue bags that line all your organs were there right from the start. They were one of the first things that began to form. And that's how important they are. It wasn't an afterthought. Oh, we need to put the heart in a bag. The heart was always inside these little bags. Now, of course, if these are the heart tubes, the heart's going to have to get in a bag. This is going to become a lot more complicated, right? Because it is going to also form the respiratory system, the lungs and the trachea. So let's say something grows off of here, this yellow starts to expand and grows something, it's going to push that red bag out of the way. So anything that grows out of here is going to still be inside the bag, right? So anything that forms in the gut tube will be pre-bagged. Now just a couple more things I want you to know, that the top side here, this side of the embryo, is now called the dorsal side, and dorsal is Latin from back, it means back. And this side down here is called the ventral side, and that's from ventra, meaning stomach. So we're looking at the embryo like this, sort of, right? With the back and then the stomach, the ventral side. And we did see that we're actually looking at it this way with the head up here. We don't have any feet yet, right? There's no appendages. But the bottom of the spine would be the first part of this disc, right? Like up here, how it began. Basically, this is going to be the head and mouth region, the brain, and the spinal column region. So the arms and legs will come later. It's basically just like the torso, like that. And one last thing, I want to look at a couple of pictures. First, a diagram that's basically of this over here. Let me zoom out just a little bit. And we see just one side of it. There's the neural tube. And here's the notochord, the somite. It's called the aorta, but it's a heart tube. And so this would be that upper and lower branch going off. And then the next picture is going to be as if we bend this down like this. Imagine this curving like all the way down, so that this endoderm is just going to come down here instead of going out. And of course, this is an actual photograph, an SEM, scanning electron micrograph. So we have no color, but we have great 3D and texture. So here's the neural tube. Here's a somite. Here's a somite. Here's the notochord. And we can even see the ectoderm layer. Oops. Running along here. You can actually see like the little cells. It looks like there's little sections here, so I'm thinking maybe those are actual cells. They're not labeled as such, but at this scale, those could be the actual cells. So down here, let's see, below the notochord, we have the endoderm. So this would be our yellow layer bending around. And all of this, this is the intermediate mesoderm. That's where that urogenital tract is going to develop, the kidneys and such. And then the lateral plates are going down here, like they would be extending right about here is where they split. So one would go here, one would go here. So the other thing I wanted to show you was something I talked about earlier in the drawing. That is what happens when the neural tube doesn't close all the way, or what happens if this doesn't close all the way. Now in the case of the neural tube, if this doesn't completely enclose and go down here, if this stays open so that part of the spinal cord is sticking out, it causes something called spina bifida. And that's what it looks like on the baby. And this is a diagram of what's happening. This is a cutaway of the vertebrae. So you can see this is the soft cord inside, and it loops out. There's a little gap in the bones, and the cord is sticking out. It was supposed to be tucked all the way down in here. And here's something that happens if this primitive streak doesn't stop growing. See, it performs a temporary function, and then it's supposed to turn into the neural tube. But what happens if the primitive streak stays primitive? And you can get something like this. Sacrococcygeal teratoma. That's a mouthful. And it's basically a lump. You call it a tumor, but not like a cancerous tumor. Benign. It's just a lump. It's not really dangerous. It's just very inconvenient. And here's another picture. Okay, so it occurs right there at the bottom, at their bottom, right? Because the primitive streak was right where the bottom ends, and the legs are down here. So that's exactly the location that you would expect problems with the primitive streak. And so this, interestingly enough, it happens more with girls than boys. I don't know why that is, but I read that little piece of trivia. And so the surgeons have to try to cut that off and reconstruct their rear end to make it look normal. Now, what happens if the embryo doesn't fold completely together? This is supposed to shrink down and tuck up and disappear, except for we are going to have an umbilical cord coming out. So the only place in your body where it's correct not to completely close in is right where your belly button is. And if you put your finger in your navel, in your belly button, and push a little bit, you'll be able to feel that there's no muscle behind there. The opening stayed. However, in the rest of the body, this is supposed to close up. And if it doesn't close up, let's say up in the head region, you can get something like this, which is cleft palate, and there's this split going up through the palate of the mouth, through the nose. And fortunately, doctors know how to repair that. So there's a baby that had surgery, and they fix it up, and he or she looks just fine now. So that was an awful lot for one drawing. The next drawing is going to have some review. We'll do some new things, but we are going to see some of this again, so you'll kind of get a little bit of review.